Today we are going to be going over some basic sorting algorithms. Simple case, you have a list of numbers and you want to sort that into numerical order. And there's all sorts of reasons you want to do that. Say you've got a spreadsheet open and you want to sort one column, that uses a sorting algorithm. But also there's the less obvious applications, all sorts of artificial intelligence stuff. If you're playing a computer game and there's some sort of AI somewhere, there will be somewhere. They'll definitely be using sorting to find the best way to go about doing something. Let me explain how bubble sort works. I've got some playing cards here. So I'll deal them out upside down so I can't see. Hopefully they won't come out sorted. So we've got 5, 3, 7, 8. Okay, so this is actually going to be quite a boring bubble sort. You go through the list, you compare each pair of elements in turn, and if you need to swap them, you swap them. So do we need to swap 3 and 5? Yes, because 3 is lower than 5. Okay, so we swap those over, and then we look at 5 and 7. Do we need to swap those? No, we don't. 7 and 8, do we need to swap those? No, we don't. So then we go back to the start of the list, and do we need to swap 3 and 5? No. 5 and 7, no. 7 and 8, no. That was very simple, very easy. Once we've gone through the list one full time and there's no swaps, we know the list must be sorted. So I'll show you that with a few more cards. Okay, so let's deal out 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 cards. Okay, so we start from the left. Do we need to swap 7 and 3? Yes. Do we need to swap 7 and 10? No. Do we need to swap 10 and 6? Yes. 10 and 4? Yes. 10 and 8? Yes. 10 and 5? Yes. 10 and 7? Yes. Okay, let me go back to the start. Do we need to swap 3 and 7? No. 7 and 6? Yes. 7 and 4? Yes. 7 and 8? No. 8 and 5? Yes. 8 and 7? Yes. 8 and 10? No. Back to the start. 3 and 6? No. 6 and 4? Yes. 6 and 7? No. 7 and 5? Yes. 7 and 7? No. 8 and 7? No. 8 and 10? No. Back to the start. 3 and 4? No. 4 and 6? No. 6 and 5? Yes. 6 and 7? No. 6 and 7? No. 7 and 8? No. 8 and 10? No. Back to the start. 3 and 4? No. 4 and 5? No. 5 and 6? No. 6 and 7? No. 7 and 7? No. 7 and 8? No. 8 and 10? No. So we've sorted the list. That took a lot of effort. And if you had even more cards, it would take even longer. You can actually make bubble sort slightly simpler. So let me just do a quick first pass over this. So we swap those, don't swap those, don't swap those, don't swap those, don't swap those, do swap those, do swap those. What you do know is after every pass, the highest card will definitely have been swapped all the way to the end. So actually, you don't need to check that one anymore. You can move that off and just go, right, do I need to swap those? No. Those? No. Those? No. Those? No. Those? No. Those? Yes. Okay, so now you know 8 is actually the next card there. But it's still not a very good algorithm. I can demonstrate merge sort to you if you like. So for that, I have got another prop. We bring in this. So I'll deal out 7 cards. For merge sort, we split the list into 2 parts. Okay, so we've got this left half goes there and the right half goes there. So we've got 2 lists now. This list gets split into 2. This list gets split into 2. And then each of these 4 lists gets split into 2 until you've got either 1 card or no cards in your list. Now what we do, we look at each of these pairs of sorted lists and we merge them back together in the right order by looking at the top card on each list. So first of all, we put 4 and then we put 7. Okay, so now that's a sorted list there. Okay, so we're 10 and 8. We look at the lowest card, put that in first. We've got 8, then we've got 10. And then this one we've got 5 and then we've got 7. And with these two, we've got 3 out of the empty list, so 3 just goes there. Hopefully everyone will agree that a list with just 1 card in it is sorted. I've separated them just for clarity so you can see the cards. You should only be able to look at the top element of each list. So now what we do, we merge these 2 sublists back together. Which is the lowest card between 4 and 8? Those are the only 2 we can see. So we pick 4, that goes in that list. And then we say, which is lowest between 7 and 8? It's 7. Which is lowest between 8 and nothing? It's 8. And then similarly with 10 and nothing, it's 10. And then we look at these 2 lists, we pick the lowest, so we've got 3. And then we've got an empty list, so we just put 5 there and 7 there. So we've got 2 sorted lists now, and all we do is merge them back together. So we've got 4 here and 3 here. So 3 is lowest, so that goes first. Between 4 and 5, 5 and 7, and 7 and 7, and 7 and 8 is 7, 8 and nothing it's 8, and then between 10 and nothing it's 10. I did 3 tests. We've got bubble sorts, we've got the slightly better bubble sort, which is the one where you check less elements each time because you know the highest ones are already sorted. So we can see that actually around the low end, merge sort can be significantly slower than either bubble sorts. And that's because merge sort's got slightly more overhead associated with it and Also, I guess the lists are more likely to be sorted or nearer sorted when they're smaller. So we've got the input size here, so I sorted 10 things in this row. I ran it 1,000 times for each, so 1,000 different randomly sorted lists. So it took 391 nanoseconds to sort 10 things with the first bubble sort, 322 with the second bubble sort, and 770 with merge sort. Even though merge sort should be quicker, there's going to be a little bit of overheads. It's a slightly more complicated sorting algorithm. However, as the input size gets bigger, if we get to 100, say, bubble sort took 28,000 nanoseconds. The beta bubble sort took 19 microseconds, and merge sort took about 8 microseconds. So you can see there that the merge sort's already starting to take over, even by 100. So let's see what it's like at 1,000. Bubble sort is taking 3 milliseconds to sort a list of 1,000 things. The beta bubble sort is taking 2 milliseconds, and merge sort is taking 0.1 of a millisecond to sort the list. With a small n, it doesn't really make much difference, but with a big n, it makes a world of difference. It's really important. Okay, so at 5,000, it was taking 77 milliseconds to sort with bubble sort, 51 milliseconds to sort with a beta bubble sort, 0.65 of a millisecond to do merge sort. Bubble sort, as I said earlier, scales with the square of the input size. So we're going to call the input size n. So we can say bubble sort scales with n squared. Merge sort that we've just done, that scales with the input size times the log of the input size. A log is, it's just the inverse of a power. So if you've got 10 to the power of 3, say, is 1,000, log to the base 10 of 1,000 is 3. Whatever the base of the log is, it's just a constant factor in front of it, and that doesn't matter. Merge sort will always take n times log n runtime. So in the best case and the worst case and the average case, you've always got to split the list into two, and into two again, and into two again, and then you've still got to compare them all and merge them back together. So that one, that one, that one, that one. So you've kind of always got to do the same number of steps. The best case of merge sort is still n log n, whereas bubble sort, what you'll find is if you've got a list that's already sorted, it will only take n steps to do it, because all it's doing is goes, do I need to sort these? No. Do I need to sort these? No. Do I need to sort these? No. Okay, so you've done basically n steps, so it's proportional to the number of cards. You don't need to do any swaps, so you're done. But if you want to sort a list with a million things in, bubble sort's not the way to go. You need to be able to succinctly convey how an algorithm scales. There's some mathematical notation used by computer scientists. This is called big O notation. So actually what you might find is your actual algorithm might run in n squared plus 4n plus 10. But what you don't write n squared plus 4n plus 10. You can just chuck away the lower order terms. So you just take the term that scales biggest. So you can cross off those and you just say it's O of n squared. Okay, and the reason is, as you increase n, the n squared term will always dominate 4n. So if n is 1, we get 1 squared, which is 1, plus 4 times 1, which is 4, plus 10. So you can see this term is actually the biggest one, and then this term's biggest, and then the n squared term's smallest. But if n is 2, we get 2 squared, which is 4, we get 2 times 4, which is 8, and then we've still got 10. But if we make n 10, we get 10 squared here, which is 100, we get 4 times 10, which is 40, and then we've got 10 here. But as n gets bigger, the n squared term, it dominates the rest, so the n squared term really takes precedence over the others. With big O, we only care about the highest order term, so n squared.
So is it a way of saying there is other stuff that goes along with
this? There might be other stuff, but it's a way of simplifying it. When we were looking at the figures from my tests, merge sort was a bit slower actually at the start than bubble sort. That's probably because there's some big constant factors in there or some overhead that is making it take longer. There are some algorithms that scale the order of n factorial. It's n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 times all the way down to 1. We've got n and n factorial. N is 1, n factorial is 1, n is 2. It's 2, it's 3, we've got 3 times 2 times 1, which is 6, and it's 4, we've got 6, it's 6, it's 720, we've got 7, it's whatever 7 times that is, quite a big number. By the time you get to 70 factorial, my calculator doesn't like it because you've gone over 10 to the power of 100. I can show you a sorting algorithm that, in the average case, is n factorial, if you like. So we've got some cards, you throw them up into the air, and pick them up. We check if they're sorted. So are they sorted? No. Right. So we chuck them up in the air again. One's got on the floor. Pick them up. Are they sorted? No. I mean, it could be here forever. But in the average case, it's the factorial of the number of cards. So we've got 7 cards here. So it's going to it's going to take me a long time. This is called BOGO sort, by the way. Interesting though, BOGO sort has got a best case complexity of n, because if the list is sorted, you check if it's sorted, and it is, so you've finished. You've only done n steps.
Does anything that you know of use BOGO sort in a practical?
I don't think so. I think the term was invented just for sort of instructive purposes, so you can kind of have an example of an n factorial algorithm. I mean, you'll find it in practice quite difficult to write any algorithm that runs an n factorial. It's difficult. Even if you're a really bad programmer, you'd struggle. You'd probably have to be quite a good programmer to work out how to do something that runs that badly.